I was walking down a street in a very palatial, very adequate neighborhood. Suddenly, a man ran past me. A woman cried out, "Robber! Robber!" Panic struck in my heart. And then the police came and arrested the man. And the woman said it was a terrible thing, an awful feeling, for someone to take what was mine and act like it was his. We know how the people of God might have felt then when, around 425 BC, God said the following, "Listen, for I am the Lord, I do not change. Therefore you are not consumed, O son of Jacob. Yet from the days of your fathers you have gone away from my ordinances and have not kept them. Return to me, and I will return to you, says the Lord of hosts. But you said, in what way shall we return? Will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me. But you say, in what way have we robbed you? In tithes and offerings. You are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, the whole nation. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house, and prove me this day, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such a blessing that there will not be room to receive it." Hear the word of the Lord. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have blessed us so richly, and you have guided us in how we are to give in affirmation of your lordship. Guide us now as we seek to understand how to respond and how to give of ourselves. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Someone does not want me to preach this sermon. This sermon is about thriving through tithing. And there are lots who do not want me to preach the sermon. Perhaps there's a husband or wife sitting next to his or her mate saying, "How did you know? I've wanted to tithe all along, but my husband or my wife hasn't wanted to." Perhaps there are some singles here who are saying, "Oh, my friends tell me this is absolutely absurd. You can't give away all that money. That's an Old Testament, antiquated request of God that has no meaning today. Don't get caught up in the cycle of that." Perhaps your accountant is the one who doesn't want this sermon preached. Perhaps he or she is saying, "Wait a minute. You can't make ends meet if you give that much away. Got to take care of your creditors first." And perhaps it is a creditor who's saying, "I don't want that sermon preached." Listen, if he or she takes seriously what you have to say, I might not get my bills paid. And perhaps the person who doesn't want this sermon preached is inside your own skin. Perhaps right at this moment you're saying, "It is I, It is I. We're living in tough times, and money just doesn't stretch, and I faithfully pay all my bills, and then I try and give to the Lord, and there's nothing left. But there's someone else who doesn't want this sermon preached. His name is Satan. He doesn't want this sermon preached because he knows that when people begin to give according to the biblical mandate, wonderful things happen in their lives. They are blessed spiritually and materially. They get on the move as disciples of Christ. And there's no telling what could happen. But he also knows this. A church has revival and new life and power that grips it when its members begin to tithe. He knows something else. Fantastic things begin to happen in the mission of the church, in a community, and around the world, when people take seriously the call of God to tithe. It's fascinating to note that the missionary movement of the last century is directly related to the rediscovery and recovery of the meaning of tithing. The resources that were necessary to reach out to the world were made possible because of a new discovery of a historic and ancient call of God that his people who belong to him should tithe. But dear friends, I want to tell you, I believe in one who is greater than the forces of evil. And he who is in the world is inferior to the one who lives in me. And I'm going to preach it anyhow. Because I believe that your spiritual life is at stake, and so is mine. The future life of this church and this ministry of reaching out to the nation through media is at stake. That's why we have to face what God has said to us about the future of his mission and his mandate that we tithe. About 425 BC, Israel was facing a terrible period in its history. The people of God had been returned from Persia. The temple had been rebuilt. But there was apathy that soon slipped into apostasy. The priesthood became corrupt. The sacrifices in the temple were not pure and powerful because the priesthood had moved away from a basic commitment to God. Blemished, blind, crippled animals were sacrificed in the temple. The best were used for people's own satisfaction. They were not giving their best to God. And in the midst of it, the Lord sent a prophet by the name of Malachi. And he said, "You're robbing me." "How are we robbing you?" the people responded. "With your tithes and offerings," he said. He called the people of God robbers, embezzlers, because they were using what was not theirs. And God called them to tithe. And then he promised that if they would, he would open the windows of heaven and pour out so great a blessing they wouldn't even be able to contain it or receive it. It would be so great. Where did the idea of tithing come from? Oh, it goes way back. Hundreds and hundreds of years before Malachi's time, way back to Abraham. You remember the story? Check it, if you will, in the 14th chapter of Genesis, the 20th verse. Remember? When Lot, Abraham's nephew, was defeated in a skirmish between the king of Sodom and other kings, and was taken captive, and all his possessions and family with him. And Abraham wouldn't take that. He gathered together 318 of his strongest men and went against those kings and defeated them. and as a result took a great spoil, a booty. And there he was, all alone, looking at all that he had taken. And a strange, mysterious figure by the name of Melchizedek came to him and said, "Hail, Abraham, blessed are you. You are blessed by the Most High God." And in response to the affirmation of the blessing of God, Abraham gave a tenth of the spoils of the battle. Now that's the first time that tithe is mentioned in the scriptures. But as a result of the inspiration of Abraham to tithe, he taught his son Isaac, and Isaac taught Jacob, and Jacob taught his sons, and they carried that message with them into Egypt. And there under servitude, they remembered that the way that they glorified God was with the tithe. And then when the Lord liberated them from Egypt, God sent one by the name of Moses. And over again, he called the people back to this basic, fundamental principle that obedience to God meant that the first tenth of the income and the resources of the land belonged to God. Leviticus 17:30, the tithe is the Lord's. But Israel had to recover that over and over again. And it was at this time in Israel's history when Malachi proclaimed the message, "You have robbed me," that the people were called back to tithe. The tithe is assumed by Jesus. When he proclaimed his message, he fulfilled the law. He didn't contradict it. No wonder then in Matthew chapter 23, verse 23, he looked the Pharisees straight in the eye and he said, "You hypocrites, you tithe mint and anise and cumin, and you neglect the weightier matters of the law, such as justice and mercy and faith. These ye should have done without neglecting the others." Jesus called for a greater loyalty to justice, mercy, and faith without neglecting the basic law that God had given all along, that the way his people honor him is by giving the first tenth to him for his work and the spreading of his love. Jesus assumed it. He didn't contradict it. And I believe that if he wanted to throw out the tithe, that would have been the moment. He would have said to the people, "You don't need to tithe anymore. I'm going to Calvary and that'll take care of everything. You don't need to be faithful to God and how you spend your money anymore." But he didn't. He said, "You tithe all of these things. That's fine. But now let's get on to the bigger things of justice and mercy and faith. And when you have that, you will fulfill God's obligation to tithe." The Apostle Paul assumed it. With the clarity, he called the people out of gratitude for what God had done in Jesus Christ to give. He just assumed that the tithe would be there and ask them to give way beyond that. Now, what does that mean to you and to me? Why tithe? First of all, dear friends, because it's biblical. We believe that the Bible is the authoritative, inspired Word of God. You can't tear out one page and say, "That's irrelevant," and seek to know God in another page. If we're going to take some of the promises of the prophets and throw them out because they affect us personally, we're going to be in trouble. Because there are other promises that we desperately need to live. But secondly, why tithe? Because it brings honor and glory to God and brings delight to his heart. Over and over again, I'm aware of the fact that what we do affects God. He's entrusted to us the resources of the world and adequate resources to live, and how we use them gives him great pleasure. And he's entrusted to us what we have so that he can use them in order to get his work done in the world. You can bring delight to God's heart when you do things his way. Why tithe? Because through the tithe of the people of God, great things get done for the Master. We need to win our world for Christ. We're living in a time of history when God has created a greater receptivity all over the world than has ever been known in human history. Now is the time. Now is the time to reach out and preach the gospel and lead people to him, to care for the sick and the poor and the needy. This is history's finest hour. And only tithers can support it. And the Lord waits to bless. Tithing is always the prelude to a revival. And oh, how we need a revival in our world today. But more than that, why tithe? Because it'll change your life. I was led to tithe when I was poorer than any other time in my life. I was so poor, we couldn't even buy diapers for our children. I went to a friend and I said, there's something wrong with my spiritual life. I just don't have power. He looked me squarely in the eye and said, Lloyd, do you tithe? I said, tithe? I can't even pay my bills. I can't pay for my education. That's still hanging over me. And here I was, a pastor of a little country church, making a subsistence salary. And this man said, do you tithe? Well, I went home and talked to Mary Jane about that. She said, how can we do it? And we began to pray about it. And we made the commitment. Well, 2 months went by. We paid our tithe, and we were really short of money. As a matter of fact, we couldn't pay our bills. So we said, aha, see, it doesn't work. Then one day, I was moving the couch in the living room of the house in which we lived. We had taken the mail a few days before and just left the stack on top of the couch, and one envelope had fallen down behind the couch. And it was a check from a man by the name of Yeager Cantwell, prominent lawyer in Chicago, who had decided to give a part of his tithe to the ministry of our church. And then, in addition to that, a personal gift to help us. The amount of the money was what we were in debt. And I said, oh God, why did I doubt you? And I want to tell you, it's worked ever since. Now, what does this mean to you personally? Are you a tither? If you are, you're cheering this because you know what it means. If you aren't, start now. When do you start? Not when you think you're ready, because you'll never be ready. And it comes right off the top, not off the last 10%, or you'll never do it. What a dynamic movement of faith and trust in God it is. It's getting out on a limb with him to do things His way, by His power. And the results are magnificent. Start tithing now.